wonderful singing. Let's pray. Heavenly Father God, we do give you praise tonight, and we do give you glory for your amazing, wonderful, matchless, marvelous, and the list could go on and on and on of description of your great grace. Well, thank you for that grace that's been bestowed upon us. Thank you for the grace that brought to our hearts salvation. Thank you for the grace that brings to our lives a keeping. And thank you for the grace that finds in life a sufficiency for God to meet our needs. I pray you'd bless our service tonight. Lord, do a work in our heart. Draw us close together as a body of believers. When we leave here tonight, may we leave here eager about the week, ready to serve you with our whole heart. Bless us as we greet one another, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Turn around, shake hands. Welcome all those around you. Don't miss anybody.
Pastor wants to embarrass you, recognize you for your accomplishments. So on 574, a child of the king. Thank you.
I love that third verse of that song. Born a sinner and an alien by birth. I hope you understand the spiritual context of that great statement. I believe Miss Sonia Roper is our graduate tonight. Are there? Come up here, dear lady. Come on. You've got quite a accomplishment that God has done in your life, and I want to tell everybody about it. First off, your knees are shaking. Okay. Would it help to know mine are too? How long have you come to Plantation Baptist Church?
Since 2000.
2000. Amen. And your mom and your dad, are they here? Are they here tonight?
No, they're not here tonight.
And your children, give your children and their names.
Craig Jackson, who's over there.
Stand up, Craig. Be proud.
And Christopher Jackson, who is not here.
And Christopher graduated this year?
Yes, he did. He graduated from University of South Florida with a Bachelor's of Science and Information Studies.
And stand right here and tell the people what you graduated in, where you graduated from, and what you plan to do.
I graduated from Nova Southeastern University with a doctorate in healthcare education. And I plan to teach nursing.
Now, a question. Did you or Christopher get a higher GPA?
Christopher didn't, but I got a 3.85.
She loves the Lord. And a marvelous saint, a marvelous lady in our church. And to whom much is given, much is required. God's let you do this. God's going to continue to do great things in you and great things through you. And I'm excited to be part of that.
Thank you.
And we love you very much. Do you have enough strength in your knees to go back to your seat or not? Go ahead. Would you welcome, give her applause one more time. Oh, so, Sonia, we have a gift for you. And this is a gift fit for a person with a doctor's degree. That just means it's probably real leather, not pleather. All right, a couple of announcements here. Don't forget on your vacation Bible school to be in prayer, to stop by the table and purchase your t-shirt or your shirt. It's $5. We are asking for that. Parents, let's be honest. How many of you have gone online and registered your child for Vacation Bible School already? Okay, about 5 of you. Wonderful. The rest of you, would you please do that? Before you go to bed tonight, just go on our church website, register your child. If you wait till Monday to do this, we're Christians, we can't kill you, but we will take you off the prayer list, I promise you for that. So make sure you do. Some of our young people went into the community on Saturday and were putting door flyers and inviting people to Vacation Bible School. Take Vacation Bible School seriously. You see children in your neighborhood. You have children as neighbors. You have family members that don't go to church or whatever. You invite them. Let me tell you something. The gospel of Christ changes people's lives. Okay? And it can take a little child that maybe in a difficult home or a difficult situation, and Christ can come into their heart and into their life, and God can change that life, and God can take and work in that and do what only He can do. So I would beg you to pray about that, think about that, have it in your private time and remembrance as you come to the throne of grace, lifting it there. Wilds Camp sponsorship. We got 4 students that need money. And if they don't get money, they can't go. That's just the flat way it is. It's expensive, so I'm not asking everybody to do a whole one. It costs about $400 to send a kid for camp. But there's a verse in the Bible that says many hands. It's not in the Bible. Good job. there's an old adage that says many hands make light work. Okay? So If you wanted to put a little extra in the offering and just write on there, camp scholarship, I can read you their names, but I'm not going to read you their names. They just need help, and if you could just trust me about that, that would be a blessing. They're going to leave on Father's Day. I told the church on Wednesday night that between our church and our sister church, we got about 100 people going to camp this year. It's fantastic. So if you could help, that would be a blessing. Men, I'm supposed to remind you, and I should have done this sooner, but our Amen ministry is on June 25th. Remember, we had homework to do. Remember, you're supposed to have somebody that you're going to introduce at that meeting and getting to know that man in our church, learning some things about them, a statement or two that shows that you did your work. I hope and pray that you're working on that, or at least I'll remind you about that to accomplish that if you can, please. Wednesday night, we'll have our Bible study and speaking on chastening. What does the Bible say about chastening? On the Sunday or the Wednesday, we have Vacation Bible School. There will be no Bible study. I made an announcement tonight to the choir that I want to tell you about before we have our prayer, and then the orchestra is going to play. Everybody needs rest. Everybody needs rest. Every ministry needs rest. And I realized and came to my attention that we have been in two services now, I think going on 4 years. And for those 4 years, the choir has been coming to 8:30 and 11 and singing faithfully and doing just a marvelous job. So I moved in my spirit. I told Brother Jeff, I said, we need to give the people a break. So the choir is going to take off the month of July. There'll be 5 Sundays there that they will not sing, nor will they practice, and they'll just rest. Brother Jeff will be able to do some planning as we move into the fall. Hard to believe we're talking about fall, and then I could even say Christmas season, you know. Of course, when you work with Joey Callahan, it's Christmas every day, right? So the very first Sunday of July, or the last Sunday of June, will be the last time they'll sing, and then they'll take off those five Sundays in the month. And I hope you'll be able to understand that. They need some time to rest and recoup and then come back in the month of August. And we'll have some specials throughout that, but we're going to give them a break. Also, pray about joining the choir if you can sing. If you can sing, if you can carry a tune and you can sing and you would want to be used in a ministry. I don't know about you, but choir, just let me tell you, sitting there as a normal church person, there are times that the choir prepares my heart to preach the word of God. I look forward to that time. I'll miss it for a break, but I know we need it. So if you're looking forward to that ministry as well. I understand the orchestra is going to play Standing on the Promises. Stand Up for Jesus. You told me that. Stand Up for Jesus. And this also is not in the Bible. I think I saw it on a movie somewhere, and it went like this. If you build it, they will come. You saw the same movie I did, didn't you? And so we started with a small little group, and now it's mushrooming into a larger group. And we praise God for that. Thank you for using your abilities. And so they're going to play our offertory. Men, if you'll wait on us for our offering, we'll have our prayer and we'll have our offering. Pray with me if you would, please. Heavenly Father God, thank you for allowing us to be a child of the King. What a great hymn. I love that line where it said, born a sinner and an alien by birth, but I've been adopted in the family of God. And one of the great joys about singing hymns are the truth in those verses. Powerful truth. If people would just read the words as they sing and think about them, there's spiritual work that can be done in their heart. I'm a child of the King. I will never be lost, never separated, never not your child. God, I'm not a child of the King because of any merit of my own other than I received the Lord Jesus as my Savior. And I thank you for that. What a joy to be in the family of God. What a joy it is to be part of this church family. Thank you for what you're doing in our church. God, I thank you for your your kindness, to rest your power and your blessing upon this place. And so I pray that you would receive the offerings today for your glory. I pray, God, that you've been pleased with us, that we've brought your tithe and we've given offerings that prove our love. And I pray, God, that it just shows that we trust you and that we believe that Jesus is the Lord and that we are good stewards of all that you have entrusted to us. Thank you for the men, the women, the young people that are behind me that are getting ready to use their abilities now to bring worship and praise to your blessed name. I pray your richest blessing upon them, and may it just fill our hearts with joy. For it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. God bless you. Who were those masked people? That was awesome. I almost want to hear it again. I do want to hear it again. Practice every Wednesday night before church, don't you? It's 6:15. And what a great job. Stand up for Jesus. Thank you. It was blessed our soul tonight. If you have your Bible, turn, if you would, please, to the book of Acts. We'll begin there, the book of Acts. If you have something you may want to put in 1 Timothy chapter 2 and 1 Peter chapter 2. But find, if you would please, Acts chapter 5. Acts chapter 5 will be where we'll begin. I do want to move quickly as I am looking forward to having a moment of prayer for Brother Simeon Dunstan tonight and dedication of him and Patricia into the leadership. If you weren't here at the 11 o'clock service, I forgot at 8:30, but I was able to make the announcement that Brother Simeon Dunstan will now be our youth director. He has joined the staff of Plantation Baptist Church, and he'll be providing leadership for our 6th through 12th grade, and we're excited for him and for his wife, for the call of God upon his life, and we're trusting the Lord that under his leadership, God would continue to raise up young people that know love and want to serve the Lord. And what a delight it is. I want to preach a message tonight, or just more of a Bible lesson to follow up to today's message from the book of Ecclesiastes. We found ourselves in the 8th chapter of the book of Ecclesiastes this morning. I was able to start and to stop at the same place for the services, and so that's always helpful for our understanding when you want to do something like I want to do tonight. Solomon was teaching us how to get the most out of our lives. Really and truthfully, he's talking about a joy that will fill our lives, a joy that brings a settledness and a satisfaction to our lives. And Solomon is looking at his world as far as trying to find meaning to life from a human perspective, and all he sees is vexation and frustration. And really and truthfully, Solomon just pauses and says, I'm glad I know the truth. I'm glad I know God. Sometimes you'll hear me make a statement in reference to what's going on in our world, and I'll just simply say, I'm glad I'm saved. By the way, I hope you're glad you're saved and that you know the truth, and you have a life that's built upon the authority of the Word of God. And so Solomon said, if you're going to get the most out of life, you're going to have to understand the authority that God is and that God has. You're going to have to understand authority and your responsibility to it, as he shared with us that we have the responsibility to submit ourselves to authority, to obey authority, to side with authority, to understand the danger of going against authority. You don't ever want to align yourself against authority. Well, just join us and we're going to make a stand against the boss. Don't join them. Well, Pastor, they're going to force me to choose sides. I will remind you, you're on the Lord's side. Okay? You don't ever want to side against authority. Now, we're going to dig a little deeper into this truth tonight. Solomon says, you want to think about what you're doing. You better understand that authority has power. Authority has the final word. There's no check to the authority. They can do what they want to do. So you better think about that. And then he reminded us that we're not in charge, that there is somebody over us. And we all understand that. No man is in charge of himself. And so as Solomon is pointing to their responsibility to the king, there's wonderful application to our responsibility with the Lord. And so if I'm going to get the most out of life, I've got to understand that the Lord is the supreme authority of my life, which means I submit to him, I obey him, I side with him, I understand the danger if I go a different direction, I think about what I'm doing, and I realize that my life is not my own. He has my life. I was immediately asked after the service, and I found out through some other folks that while I was preaching, some thoughts were going through people's minds. And I wanted just to take a moment tonight and address those thoughts. Pastor, what do I do if the authority is wrong? Is there a time in my life when I've got to stand up and go against the authority of my life? What do I do if the authority of my life is wanting me to do something that's against God? Where do I stand in those positions? And so the early church was asked about this. The early church was confronted with this. Matter of fact, Peter had to address this very early in the church's young life, and we find that addressing in Acts chapter number 5. In chapter 5, you read of this verse here in verse number 29, and a lot of people know this verse, and a lot of people want to raise this verse at certain times in certain areas in their life. And Peter makes a statement in Acts chapter 5, verse 29, and this is made to the authority of his day. Then Peter and the other apostles answered and said, "We ought to obey God rather than men." And I know you're familiar with that verse, and I'm sure that there's a time where that verse is applicable, as all verses are. I want to begin by telling you what that verse is not teaching. That verse there is not teaching civil disobedience. Nowhere in the Bible do you find civil disobedience as defined by, I don't like the direction of the authority, therefore I'm not going to follow that. That makes me uncomfortable, therefore I will not do that. You do not have a good reason for this, therefore I will not submit to that. Or that goes against my, even you could say the word conscience or whatever. A lot of people want to take this phrase that Peter said, and they want to use this verse in some kind of civil disobedience to either A, do what they want to do, or to make a point, or to stand against the authority in their life. That's not what this verse is teaching. This verse, however, is teaching not civil disobedience, but it's teaching supreme obedience to God. Now, where the context of this begins all the way in chapter number 4, and if you look for sake of time, look if you would in verse number 15. But when they had commanded them to go aside out of the council, they conferred among themselves. This is when the apostles were brought in for preaching the gospel, saying, what shall we do to these men? For that indeed a notable miracle hath been done by them is manifest to all them that dwell in Jerusalem, and we cannot deny it. But that it spread no farther among the people, let us straitly threaten them that they speak henceforth to no man. Now say it, that phrase, what's the end of that verse? In this name, in this name. Underline in this name. Come over, if you would, please, to verse number 27. You ought to read the context of chapter 5. It's fascinating. But when you get to verse 27, again, the apostles are confronted about this, about their behavior. And when they had brought them, they set them before the council, and the high priest asked them, saying, did not we straitly command you that ye should not teach, say the phrase, in this name, underline in this name. And behold, you have filled Jerusalem with your doctrine and intend to bring this man's blood upon us. Now this is when Peter said, I'm sorry, but we've got to obey God rather than men. Now, somewhere beside those two verses, you need to write Luke 24, verse number 47. And then make your way, hold your hand in Acts, make your way to Luke, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. Find Luke chapter 24, and look, if you would, please, at verse number 47. These words, if you have a red letter Bible, are red. These words are recognizing the words of the Lord Jesus. We know this to be right before he ascends. So this is after the resurrection here. He's addressing the apostles and the disciples. And in Luke chapter 24, verse number 47, this is what the Bible says, Jesus says, and that repentance and remission of sins should be preached. Now what are those three words? In his name. Underline those words. In his name, among all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. And so Peter had heard the Lord Jesus give a command that said, you're going into all the world and you're going to preach repentance and forgiveness of sins and remission of sin in my name. So when the early church was empowered and the church was birthed there and it began to spread forth and go out, it had the responsibility to preach in the name of Jesus. And by the way, there's power in the name of Jesus. And the devil hates the name of Jesus. And so when these leaders began to bring persecution to them, They were asking these men to do something contrary to what the Lord Jesus had commanded them to do. And Peter said, we can't do that. We are going to obey God rather than men. Now, I believe that this got out of control as the church began to move forward. Because once again, if you hold your hand here in the book of Acts and you make your way to 1 Peter chapter number 2, all the way back in the back of your Bible, you'll find 1 Peter. Peter had to address this issue again. And he does it in chapter 2 as he's writing to this church. Remember, he's writing them to protect them and encourage them. And you come to 1 Peter chapter 2, looking at verse number 11. Peter said, "Dearly beloved, I beseech you as strangers and pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lust, which war against the soul." Boy, that reminds me of the message this morning. "Having your conversation or your life honest among the Gentiles, that whereas they speak against you as evildoers, they may be by your good works, which they shall behold, glorify God in the day of visitation." Now look at verse 13. "Submit yourselves to," what's those two words? "Every ordinance of" who? "Of man." That would include your HOA. Okay. That includes every ordinance of man. So Peter, writing to this church, is saying, now early in after the ascension of Christ and Pentecost, when persecution came in and there was this demand that they do opposite of what God wanted them to do, Peter said, wait a minute now. We got to obey God rather than man. Jesus told us to preach in his name, and we're going to preach in his name, and I'm sorry, but we cannot accommodate that. However, later, he says, every law that man makes, we need to submit ourselves to. Now, look at the motivation here, verse 13. "For the Lord's sake," okay, so I'm submitting to every ordinance of man for the Lord's sake, whether it be to the king as supreme or unto governors as unto them that are sent by him for the punishment of evildoers and for the praise of them that do well. So both directions are touched here. There's a statement that there's a time to obey God rather than men, and there's a time that you obey every ordinance of man. Pastor, where does the middle ground meet for that in the life of the believer? And I believe that the middle ground meets when it comes to the gospel of Jesus Christ and to the Word of God. And it has to meet there. It cannot meet to your expectation. It cannot meet to your understanding. It cannot even meet, per se, to our desire. The only time I find in the Bible where you obey God as opposed to obeying man is when it goes contrary to the Word of God. If you understand that, say amen. Now, you cannot twist the Word of God. For example, "Pastor, my job won't let me preach at the job." Well, you didn't get hired to preach. You got hired to work. I got hired to preach. Okay. However, if the job comes and says you can't pray at lunch, then you do what Daniel did. And you pray because God told you to pray. Now, if the job comes and says, we need you to do this, sign this when it's not true. Well, you can't sign anything that's not true because God said, let all men be liars, but God be true. Couldn't do that. So we had a man that worked here. He came to church here. He got saved, and his job was to drive his boss to girly parties. He said, "Pastor, I just can't do that." I said, "You're right. You just can't do that." So there comes a time when you have to stand up and you'll have to say, I'm sorry, but that goes against my Savior. And I'll tell you, once you make a statement that that goes against my Lord and I love my Lord, you've drawn a line in the sand. And there will be a reaction to that. But if they tell you to wear a blue shirt and you wear a white one, don't tell them Jesus is holy and you wore a white one. Okay? I want to say this too. I want you to go to 1 Timothy chapter 2. And before I make this statement, or read this, or make this point, I want to make this statement. It ought to scare you out of your mind to have to make a decision to obey God rather than man. Sometimes you get the mega Christian. And the mega Christian, I call him the Rambo Christian. Do you remember Rambo? Okay. Rambo, we all got a mental picture of Rambo. This is the guy that just thinks that because he's a Christian, it trumps everything else, and he's not submitted to the smallest of rules or so on and so forth. And this is the guy that's kind of always flaunting his Christianity and making a big deal about it to the annoyance and almost to the hurt of the Lord Jesus. And just so blatantly arrogant against authority, trying to mask it with some kind of righteousness. But I told you this morning, all authority is God's authority. Now I got to explain that. That means whatever authority is in your life, God has ordained and placed there. So the president of the United States is God's minister. He's God's man. He's been placed there by God. That's what the Bible says. You understand that? Okay. Your God-hating, sin-loving, reprobate boss is God's authority in your life. Your annoying HOA. To pastor, do you have problems with your HOA? Is God's authority in your life? So when I'm submitting to authority, I'm submitting to it for the Lord's sake. When I buck that authority, I'm bucking the authority that God has in my life. So pastor, what if the authority is wrong? Well, I think there's some wisdom there. I'll say this, that's not your problem. It's not your problem. Your responsibility is to do what the authority wants you to do. Pastor, if the authority is making me do something that's sinful or against God, then there's balance. But if the authority wants to go left and you want to go right, you better side with your authority. Amen? Ladies tell me, Pastor, I would follow my man if he was just right. That's not your problem. See, when you follow authority, then you go to God and you say, God, the authority is your problem. I'm going to do and follow this authority as unto you. Now, God, you protect me in my obedience here. Okay. Otherwise, we begin to inject ourselves into something that's not where we should be. And God always works within the realm of authority. Always works within the realm of authority. Please run away from anybody who's always bucking authority. You don't want to be part of that. So I say that to say this. It ought to scare you to death to think there would come a day in your life when you got to obey God rather than man, because there's consequences to that. So let's just name a few people. Daniel obeyed God rather than man. What happened to him? In the lion's den. Who else? Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they obeyed God. What happened to them? Fiery furnace. Who else? Jeremiah. Who else? Abraham obeyed God. He left and went out in a place he didn't know. He obeyed God with his wife and other things. Joseph obeyed God rather than man. Okay. Moses obeyed God rather than man. You have all these folks. And if you study their life, every one of them had consequences. Do you understand? If you stand up and tell your boss that I've got to obey God rather than man, you're probably going to get fired. I just want you to be aware of this so we're humbled a little bit. It's pretty, people ask me all the time, so where's the middle line or where's the balance? I'll tell you what the middle line and the balance is. If you're scared out of your mind, you probably found the balance. And then you better fall on your face and you better say, God, where do I stand with this authority? What do you want me to do? And I don't know about you, but the Spirit of God speaks to me in my spirit. If he speaks to you, would you just acknowledge that by saying amen? And then you got to do what God, how God leads you. But there needs to be a little bit of fear and trepidation here as we move forward. Look, if you would, at 1 Timothy chapter 2. I exhort, therefore, that first of all, supplications, prayers, intercession, and giving of thanks be made for all men, for kings and for all that are in, what's that word? Authority. That we may lead a quiet and peaceable life. That verse right there is telling you, you should be praying for the authority in your life. Pastor, I can't pray for that guy. He's wicked. No, you should be praying for the authority. You should be praying that God would give them wisdom. You should be praying that God would touch and change their heart. You should be praying that God would use them in your life. And you should be praying that God would enable you to know a quiet and peaceable life when it comes into the realm of authority. And by the way, this is evidence, if you look at the end of verse number 2, a quiet and peaceable life in all, what are those two words? Godliness and honesty. For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God, our Savior. And so, yeah, there will be a time when we obey God rather than men, but there's consequences to that. And you better make sure that's what God would have you to do. You better make sure and understand that your responsibility is to pray for your authority, that you can live a quiet and peaceable life. Timothy's really picking up on what Solomon said there. Solomon said, if you want to get the best out of life, understand authority. Timothy, or Paul says, if you want to lead a quiet and peaceable life, pray for those that are in authority over you. Authority says a lot about us. Here's why authority says a lot about you. Help me with this verse. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. When you read the rest of Philippians chapter 2, you find out that he had a spirit of submission. And one of the evidences that you're saved is that you don't have a problem with authority. Sometimes people say, Pastor, I have a problem with authority. And I say to them, you should be saved. They don't like that. They don't like that. And I'm not saying a Christian can't have a problem with authority. But when a Christian runs into authority, they're to submit to that authority. If you cannot submit to authority, then that person's filled with pride, not filled with the Spirit of God. Amen. Well, Pastor, that's easy for you to say because you don't have a boss. You know, I have 600 bosses. I do. I look at you as my boss. If Simeon says, Pastor, we're going to have a youth activity, will you come help? He's my boss. I'll do whatever Simeon wants me to do. Joey says, hey, we're going out here to cut trees. Joey's my boss. So all the other guys are like, can't you tell him to stop? He's my boss. I have learned that God never steps outside of authority. And if I want to be blessed, I need to understand authority in my life, and so do you. And please, for the love of God, teach your children to respect authority. I don't know what we're going to do. The Bible said about the nation of Israel, when there was no king in the land, every man did that which was right. How? In his own eyes. Shall we pray? Heavenly Father God, the more we read the word, the more we face life, the more we face the tests and trials of life, the more we realize how much we don't know. But this one thing I do know, you're my God. You love me. Your grace is sufficient, and your wisdom will bring life to me. God, there might be a time where we'll have to stand up as a church and tell our nation we've got to obey God rather than man. I think we're moving there pretty quickly. But we need to be humbled about that. We need to understand that there will be consequence to that. We also need to understand that we have a responsibility to authority, to pray for those that are in authority, that we may lead quiet and peaceable lives. If we would just read the word, it would give us direction in our life. And so, God, I pray that we would know your leadership. When we go to work and they tell us we have to do one thing, and if that goes against the gospel or goes against your word, then we can't do that. They can't tell me not to talk about the Lord as far as my own time. I can, maybe when I work for them, I can't, but I can at least praise you. They can't tell me I can't mention the name of God. I would have to mention the name of God. The Bible says that everything that hath breath, praise the Lord. They can't tell me that I got to be dishonest. I can't do that. That goes against the God's word. But they can tell me I didn't do a good job, do it this way. They can tell me to go left and I should go left. They tell me to wear blue, I better wear blue. All authority is your authority. What a statement. What a truth. Help us, God, that we would be good testimonies for the gospel of Jesus Christ in the workforce, in the authority of our lives. And God, put a hedge of protection around us. And I pray, Lord, that you would be merciful to us as Americans and continue the freedoms we have to worship you the way we do. Meet our need. Thank you for a great day. In Jesus' name, amen. Brother Simeon, would you and Patricia come forward at this time? I'm going to ask the deacons to come. And I'm going to ask any pastor that's in the room if he would come. And I want to just lay hands on them and have two men pray for them. And ask God's blessing upon them. We'll use those two chairs. Front and center. Right there. Come on. All right. Go ahead, Miss Patricia, Miss Simeon. Man, if you'll just gather around. Now, the last thing you got to do is put your weight on them. Don't put your weight on her. Just put your hand on her. Your weight gets heavy. Isn't it awesome to be able to pray and dedicate two people to the service of the Lord? It's fantastic for our church. Gather around, grab, just choose one of them. Put a hand on one of them. And Brother Bill Sr., I want you to come and I want you to pray. And I want you to do that. Brother Matt, I want you, as your Simeon's friend, I want you to pray for him. And you have the senior pray. And then we'll have the junior pray.
Simeon and
Patricia. And ask God's blessing, His protection, wisdom, and power, and for God to do a work in the young people of our church through this ministry and dedicate their service to the Lord. Amen. Matt, you finish, and then I'll pray. I'd ask you to bow your head and pray at this time as well.
Dear Heavenly Father, we come before thy presence today, and what a wonderful occasion it is to see young people set aside for the ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we pray for Simeon and Patricia, and particularly, Lord, their family. It's a big step to take. I can remember I was in my 20s when I took that step, and it's been a glorious thing, and the Lord has blessed it, and he will continue to do so. I thank you for our church. I thank you for our pastor and for the leaders of our church. I pray, Father, that more and more young men and women will be called into the work of the Lord. Sometimes, Father, it's one thing and sometimes it's another. But once again, it is your work and your ministry, and we thank you for that. I pray, Heavenly Father, that as they are set aside for your work, that we will do everything we can to encourage them, to uphold them, to pray for them, so that indeed the work that you have given them to do will be accomplished. Thank you for our church. Thank you for its ministry. Use it for your honor and glory. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Brother Matt.
Lord, we just take this time, as it says in your word, to take a moment and especially recognize and pray for Simeon and Patricia. And some men of God here, Lord, we put our hands on them and pray for them specifically. We thank you that you called them and that you've enabled them and that you've already just, as soon as he submitted to you, Lord, that you brought amazing things in his life and you gave him assurances. And Lord, with those assurances, you already gave him small tests and he's already passed those tests, Lord, and he's submitted to you and left a promotion that he received at work and continuously submitted and decided to come here and work at the church. And we recognize that, but we also, while recognizing that submission, we pray for him, that you'll protect him, that you'll keep that spirit in him, and that you'll keep that in him and Patricia, and that you'll protect him. Help him to grow. Keep him daily in your word, to grow in wisdom, and teach him here while he serves in this ministry that he'll just be a wonderful worker for you and for the gospel. And Lord, we just take this time together as a church and as a group of men just to specifically pray that you'll put your hand and your blessing on him. And Lord, we just pray as a body that the Holy Spirit will just continuously bring Simeon and Patricia before God, and that he'll continuously remind them of the need for his power. And Jesus, will pray that you'll also continuously just bring Simeon and Patricia before God the Father, and that long after this church service is done, that the Holy Spirit and the Lord Jesus will just continuously bring them before you. We pray for them and we love them. In your name, amen.
Father, the Bible said that as they served in that church, that you said, set those men apart. And then the leadership of that church got together and recognized your calling upon their lives. And they laid hands on them and they prayed. And that's what we're doing tonight. We're laying hands on a God-called man and his wife. And we're praying. We're praying, God, because we don't know what tomorrow holds, but you do. And we're praying because prayer brings the power of God. We're praying because this is an important work that you've called them to do. We're talking about leadership in the lives of our youth and our young people. If anything, today in Grad Day, God, we've just been looking at the importance of the next generation. I preach messages sometimes and I think, oh, I pray the young people are listening. And I plead with moms and dads to teach their kids the Word of God. To be honest, so churches like our church can still exist in 25 years. The way that the world is going, there's such a lack of the way we believe that things ought to be done. And so Simeon has a heart to know you. He loves you. He reads your word. He submitted to that. And now he, along with the volunteer staff, God, that he will lead, will do that work in our young people. Give them wisdom. Give them power. Give them authority. And bless them. God, may we see teenagers come to be saved, called, and go out and serve you in whatever capacity that you'd have for them. Thank you for his wife. God, a man's wife is so important in his life. I wish that I could just hold a little service with all the wives in the church and just tell them how important they are in a man's life. And you've given him a great wife, and he will need his wife. God, he'll need her to walk with you. He'll need her for her encouragement and her inspiration. I pray for Patricia. I pray that the Spirit of God would just lift her in her heart and her spirit, protect her. And may she continue to grow in the grace and knowledge of the Lord. And I trust you for that, God. Thank you for vision. I think about our church. I think about all the vision that's being received right now. And I just know that you're in it. And we're excited about the future. It's been a great day today. We give you praise and we give you glory. And now, God, as the pastor and people of Plantation Baptist Church, we dedicate Simeon and Patricia Dunstan to the glory of God the Father. We dedicate them in service and leadership of our young people, and we say amen. And to God be the glory for the great things he hath done. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And if you rejoice, say amen. All right, wonderful. We normally go home with a song in our heart. Do we have a song, Brother? 410. Standing on the promises. I think we'll leave the men right here to be like a little mini choir. No, you can go down. Stand, let's sing 410. Let's go home. God bless you.